Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of the Venom vlog. And today we are going to start Eddie Brock week with the first story in a series of stories that we missed out on before that we didn't get to. It was something I always wanted to cover, but then I really wanted to hit like a certain point when we hit issue like our episode 200. And then I just kind of got drifted away. And then I said, all right, we'll come back to it at some point. Well, here we are. We have a week where I didn't have really anything else to post. So I figured let's go back and let's read the trade paperback, the graphic novel called Tooth and Claw, which covers a lot of stories. It's basically all the last remaining Venom stories from the 90s that we haven't talked about yet. So we have like Tooth and Claw, Venom on Trial, Sign of the Boss. There's like the Venom Effect, I think is like a one shot, and then License to Kill and the finale. So those are all the stories we're going to be going through this week. We already covered the Koba story, like the minus one issue. We already covered that, but that is in this trade as also. So if you guys are out there looking for that minus one issue and you never found it, you could pick up the Tooth and Claw trade right now on Comixology or in print. Luckily still now, as of recording this in June of 2020, it's available now and you can go pick it up and all these stories will be in there. So let's start with Tooth and Claw. This is written by Larry Hama, as are a lot of the stories in this book. Many of them are written by Larry Hama, who is a great legendary comic book writer, has done stuff like G.I. Joe, has done a lot of great stuff in Marvel and DC, and I think some DC, but a lot of Marvel stuff that I know of, and then obviously like G.I. Joe and other stuff. And I'll be honest with you, I like some of the other stories we're going to talk about later. This one I do not like. I am not a fan of Tooth and Claw. Not terrible, and some things that are set up in it and paid off, but a lot of it feels like Larry Hama. It was almost like Venom the Mace. Like when we were reading Venom the Mace, it was like, oh, it's the writer trying to call back to Shadowrunners and these other, you know, like forgotten stories that they wrote, and they're trying to tie that into this. That's what's happening here. Larry Hama is kind of going back to his Wolverine run, which was a good run, but he's trying to bring in characters from that and put them in here. So if you're just a Venom fan reading this, it's going to come across like very arbitrary stuff. Like it's like you're reading it and then it's like, oh, here's this character. Like the beginning literally opens with Eddie Brock walking down the street and then a rat says, hey, buddy, come into the alley. And then Eddie goes into the alley and the rat goes, hey, my name is Dirtnap and I eat people. And then he eats Venom and swallows him. And then, once he does, he's able to replicate who he ate. And that is a character named Dirtnap, who is a mutant, looks like a rat, but is a mutant. And every time he digests somebody or eats them, I guess, he swallows them whole, and then he can look like them. So he's kind of like a shapeshifter, but only after he eats you. And then he can store a ton of people inside of him without looking like he's, you know, really big and stuff. So, yeah, really weird character. But if you're just reading, you're just like, what happened? Page one is Eddie Brock gets talking. He's just walking randomly down an alley and then a rat says, hey, come over here. And then the rat eats him. And then you're just like, that's it. Like, that's how we're going to start this story. I feel like in some regards, as far as structure and stuff, this story is very lazy and just like coincidental. It's like, hey, I need to get Wolverine in this story. Okay, well, we'll just have Wolverine hanging out at this place that, you know, Venom goes to. And then boom, there you go. There's your story. So there's a lot of that. So we have characters like Dirtnap. You have Eddie. You have these two kids named Rocky and Jerry who are like these two skater kids. They call Eddie Rad Eddie. So yeah, very 90s, obviously. Scream, aka Donna Diego, does show up in the storyline. So we'll talk about her in a minute. Then she's on the hunt, though. Actually, we'll talk about it right now because in the beginning of the story, she is hunting for Phage's ship. And if you remember Phage from one of the earlier The Hunted storyline from Venom that we talked about, Phage was this alien that came from outer space in a spaceship, and it's there to hunt symbiotes. So she deduces, hey, when Phage came here, he knew exactly how to find us. So I'm wondering if his ship is around here. This seemed to be his kind of near his lair where he was, where we found him. And she's like, so maybe he has a ship here, and maybe on that ship there's a way to track symbiotes, and I can use it to track down other symbiotes that escaped that were left behind from Planet of the Symbiotes, which I was like, wait, what? Like, there were symbiotes left behind from Planet of the Symbiotes? So it feels like a plot thread that I don't know. Like, I don't think it gets finished either. Like, I don't know what happens to those other symbiotes because they don't talk about them in this story. And then some of the other ones we have coming up, I haven't read the finale yet. So when we get there, you know, maybe we'll find something out in the finale, because I think Larry Hama wrote that one. But yeah, it seems like one of those plot threads that I'm like, whoa, I don't remember symbiotes surviving on Earth after Planet Symbiotes, but apparently there are, and Donna wants to hunt them down. So she goes to find Phage's ship. So they kind of tie that into The Hunted. And so this is Larry Hama going, all right, let's tie in these other things that I did, like Venom related, Wolverine related, Marvel related, and let's just kind of bring it all into this Tooth and Claw miniseries with art by Joe St. Pierre, who was the artist of Planet of the Symbiotes. So maybe that's why, you know, Larry Hama wanted to reference that or build that up. But Joe St. Pierre's artwork, I like some of his stuff, but in this one, I don't know, it's not bad. You know, he's definitely got a unique style, but I just wasn't feeling it in some ways. It's very wacky. I mean, this is probably one of the wackiest Venom stories out of all the 90s stuff that I've read. This is really out there. It deals with interdimensional travel, pocket dimensions, alien spacecrafts, this girl named Chimera, who's from like a potential future, who came back in time, and she ended up at Landau, Luckman, and Lake, which is like a office of like a business office where she communicated with them about working together on hunting down certain mutants or something, and so she's looking for Dirt Nap, and then Dirt Nap is like, he has like a card saying, oh, Chimera told me to come here. And then when, he's in Eddie's body, so he shows up at the place where, the LLNL, I'll call it, the Landau, Luckman, and Lake. So he shows up at that business office, and then Wolverine just happens to be sitting there waiting for something. And you find out that one of Wolverine's friends, Emmett, who was someone who worked with at LLNL, he was someone who popped up. He's like from another dimension as well. He's like a nerdy kid, and he's like dressed like Cable. He's got big padded shoulders. He's wearing a suit that's clearly too big for him. But Emmett is just like a random character we've seen in other stuff that Larry Hama's done. And that's kind of it. It's like, that's what you get. Like, it's now that all the pieces are in place, everyone kind of descends on LLNL. Donna finds the two kids, Rocky and Jerry, the skateboarder kids, and they find the ship, and the ship, closes around them, turns into like a small football size, and then goes after trying to look for Venom, I guess, trying to hunt down Venom and capture him too. And then that leads them to Wolverine, and then a fight ensues as always, right? Like, so it's always in these instances where it's like, all right, issue two, we got to have our two heroes kind of fight each other, and then we're gonna have them team up. So actually, what I have to kind of reenact, I thought I'd do something fun today. We're going to reenact in a silly way the battle that takes place in this book between Wolverine and Venom. And so I'm going to cut to our correspondent that we have at the toy factory, where we do all of our toy reviews. I'm going to cut to him. Wiener Schnitzel, take it away. Let us know what you thought, and reenact, please, with using cool Disney figures, reenact the insane battles that happen in this book.
Hey guys, how's it going? I'm Wiener Schnitzel, and I'm here reporting on these two cool toys. We're actually going to use them to reenact an epic battle from the Tooth and Claw comic book, as Siike said. But first, we got to get them out of their packaging, but I wanted to show you what they look like. They're only $12.99, and you can pick them up at your local Disney store or buy them online as well. So without further ado, let's crack these guys open and reenact this cool scene. All right, we'll start with Wolverine because he looks like he might be easier to get out of the package. It's already ripped a little bit there, but he is figure 19 in the series, and in the back here you can see that Captain Marvel is also part of the series, as well as Spider-Man from Far From Home in that cool costume, and these retail for $12.95 at your local Disney store. So let's check out Wolverine first and see what all the hubbub is, bub. Get it? And now let's check out Venom once again, figure number 21 in the set, and he is also $12.95. Pretty good deal considering how much bigger he is than Wolverine and some of these other characters. So definitely worth the price of admission there. All right, now that we got the figures out of the box and we got their weapons and accessories, let's reenact this battle. Yay for accessories!
Take that, bub! No, little man, you will be defeated. Oh, we are Venom. Face palm. I will stab you now, bub. Oh no. You made my claws retract halfway. How can I fight you now? I come with a sword. That doesn't hurt, Venom.
Hey guys, can I come and join this fight too? I'm in this comic.
No, Donna, get out of here. Go fight Chimera over there and save those two kids and destroy that ship that the phage monster brought with him to Earth. Okay, bye.
Hey, Rhinestone Cowboys, can I join the fun too?
No, Cletus, get out of here. You're in my next series called Venom on Trial.
Okay.
I'll eat your brains. Take this, bub.
We are Venom.
Well, that was fun. Should we team up now and fight that giant rat called Dirt Nap and maybe, team up with my friend Emmett and take down Chimera? Would you be into that, Venom? Yeah, sure. That's what all these events are. We fight and then we team up. Let's just do it. Well, that's it from here, guys. Back to you, Siike, in the studio.
All right, so that's my friend Wiener Schnitzel. Thank you, Wiener Schnitzel. You didn't really do a great job there. You were kind of just smashing the toys together and talking over it and stuff, and you weren't really using dialogue from the comic at all, but hey, that's fine. That's kind of what this comic book felt like. It felt like a bunch of toys being smashed together for no real reason. And so, yeah, I don't want to, like, you know, slam on Larry Hama or anything like that too hard. I personally just didn't like this story. It just felt really weird and all over the place. And although I do like weirdness and stuff, I felt like this was just too weird. And honestly, you could follow it, I feel like, if you weren't reading Wolverine or other Marvel books, but these characters just kind of get thrown on you and they just dump a bunch of exposition to catch you up. And it's just kind of handled a little bit poorly in my mind. Like I said, other stories that we're going to talk about later this week, definitely awesome. Larry Hama does a great job on some of the other ones, especially the next one we're going to talk about, which is Venom on Trial. I really like that storyline. So we'll get into that in the next episode. But in this one, yeah, they just kind of all fight each other. Donna Diego's there. She fights Chimera, takes her out, saves the two kids. And then, you know, then I think Chimera kind of hangs on and blows open a door, and they're all about to get sucked out, go back to the real world. They do. I think, you know, Venom and Wolverine, they beat up Dirtnap, and they get him to, you know, to spit up other people that he swallowed. And Dirtnap had swallowed a kid from Wolverine comics. I think his name was Algeron, and he's like a kid from Wolverine number 95, which is also by Larry Hama, like I said. And then also this guy named Agent Smith gets spit out, who was undercover by the you know, when he got swallowed by Dirtnap. And so we're going to see more of Agent Smith coming up. So this is a way for Larry Hama to set up future stories. So that's the thing about Larry Hama's stuff, is that a lot of his runs, they're miniseries, like Venom miniseries. And as we know, all the Venom miniseries up until Larry Hama jumped on were standalone stories. Larry Hama was the first person to come in and go, all right, let's, since I'm going to be writing a couple of these, let's tie the continuity in together. And he almost made it feel like an ongoing book. The only problem is there's gaps in it where other writers come in and do other miniseries in between some of his, and it just kind of feels a little all over the place. So when you're reading this, you're like, maybe if all the Larry Hama stuff were put in one trade, you know, and just kind of like, and put in the Wolverine issues in between, maybe this would feel like a coherent run. But because it's not, it just kind of feels all over the place. Like, luckily, I read a lot of Larry Hama stuff, for the Wolverine stuff, because I have it all. I own it all. But I still was like, I don't know. The things didn't come together in this story as well as I kind of wish they would. But there's, you know, some neat moments. There's some cool stuff in it. Overall, like, you know, I like the banter between Wolverine and Eddie. Some of that's pretty fun. You know, Donna is kind of heroic in this one. You know, she does stand up to Chimera. She does save the kids. Whereas before, you know, one of the previous times we've seen Donna before, she was trying to kill the other symbiotes. And it looks like she's still hunting symbiotes, but she is still trying to save, I guess, regular people. Or at least she, you know, opens her heart enough to save these two kids and team up with them. And the kids play a big part in it, where they come through at the end, bring the spaceship around, and all the heroes jump on it and get away, while Chimera is, you know, kind of seemed like she's going to get sucked away with Dirtnap. But then she escapes and they get back into the real world. And while everyone's like, you know, Agent Smith is like, hey, I work for a special agency, the NSA and stuff. So I am here to arrest Dirtnap. And, you know, and Wolverine's like, oh, you're after mutants. You work for a mutant hunting agency. And Agent Smith's like, yes, but I'm not here for you today, Wolverine. I'm just here for Dirtnap. And, you know, and I've had a bad enough day, and I've been in this creature's stomach, in this mutant stomach, for, you know, months or whatever. So I kind of want to just get back to my life and my job. So yeah, you can go away. And Venom, thanks for your help. You can go away too. And again, setting something up there, because we're going to see that relationship with Smith and Venom come back together at the end of On Trial, and then into License to Kill. So yeah, again, Larry Hama not doing a bad job setting stuff up, but treating it like an ongoing series instead of a bunch of miniseries, which, you know, it could be good in some ways if you put it all together in one trade. But the fact that it's all sprinkled out is kind of why it felt a little messy to me. But still, not bad. I mean, not one of the worst Venom stories I read, but then again, I don't know. You know what? Maybe it is. I'm trying to be too easy and backpedal a little bit. Maybe this is one of the worst Venom stories I've ever read, to be honest with you. I just wasn't a big fan of it. I didn't like it. I point out some good things in there, but for the most part, not really. And that's why I wanted to do that fun video of just like smashing the toys together, because I was like, oh, just fill time, really. there's nothing really to go over here. It's just a big hodgepodge of events that happen, some of it by coincidence, and some of it just because the story needs it to happen. And I don't know. It just didn't feel like it mattered overall, because you could have introduced Smith into the next arc and you could have still had all that. But you got it here, and that does set up stories that we're going to get to later this week. So if you've read Tooth and Claw, and if you agree with me or disagree with me, I'd definitely love to hear your thoughts down below. Yeah, I know this wasn't a super in-depth, detailed review of it or discussion, and it's just because I didn't feel like there was a lot there I could sink my teeth into. I just felt like it was just a hodgepodge of things happening, and that can be fun for sure, but for me, it didn't pull me in enough to make me enjoy it. Like, you know, you could enjoy like something as a guilty pleasure, like, all right, it's bad, but at least I'm having fun. It walked that line of like, oh, it's fun and over the top. You know, it kind of walked that line, but then just being bad on a lot of other levels. And so for that reason, I just found myself stuck in the middle there. And I'm like, I don't feel passionate one way or the other to give this a deep, deep discussion. I just felt like this was meh. And you could kind of skip it, I would say. But I don't know, if you're a Venom fan, you got to read everything Venom, you know, pick it up. And if you have, like I said, let me know down below if you think I'm crazy or not. Let's discuss down below as always. And like I said, I'll have more Eddie Brock Week stuff coming up starting tomorrow with Venom on trial. So make sure you stay subscribed so you don't miss out. Thanks so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. And I will see you all in the future. Peace.